Welcome friends, this is a tutorial on hashing. The agenda is we will study how a dictionary can be implemented very efficiently using hashing. Dictionary is basically a set of key value pairs. We store a set of key value pairs and we typically search a pair using key. That is why it's called a key. And we will study hash table. We will understand what is a hash function. We will study that there is something called collisions, and we will study ways of handling collisions. There are two ways, chaining and open addressing. So a dictionary pair, we understand that a dictionary pair is nothing but a key value pair, and we know how to store a dictionary. There could be various ways. We could store the key value pairs in a linked list. And naturally, if it is a linked list, then when we search, we traverse the whole linked list. Hence, the order complexity will be order n. We could store it in a sorted array. And then we could perform binary search and get the work done in order log n. Insertion would still be order n, because when we find the position where to insert, we need to shift the records. And in the worst case, we may be shifting n records, hence we take order n time. If we use a binary search tree, then the search insert time is between order log n and n. So it could be log n if it is balanced, and it would be order n if it is unbalanced. So essentially the same thing. If you somehow ensured a balanced using maybe AVA tree, then you can ensure order n. So till now we have achieved success that we have been able to do it in order log n. But the critical question Hashtable asks is, can you do it in order 1? Or can you do it in close to order 1? That means the expected order complexity is order 1. So a Hashtable gives a very promising answer yes to this phenomena. To this intent. Essentially, the idea of a hash table is extremely simple. The idea is that if you could directly index based on the key in an array, you will achieve order 1. But that's not always possible, because the key can be a string. Let us say you are holding a database of students, and the key is a student name. So how could you directly index by the student name? Of course you cannot. So what we do is we index by something called output of a hash function. H is a hash function. We pass the key to the hash function, and H will return a small integer in this range 0 to, let's say, num minus 1, and we will index based on that. That is the core idea. It's a very simple idea and very powerful one. So as we discussed, we cannot directly index with the key. It's just not possible. Okay. So why? Because the key may not be of the type integer. You have a student database. The key is a student name. The range of the key's value can be extremely huge. Even if you use a student's roll number, the roll number may be an integer also, but the range is so huge that you cannot have such a big array. Because we are concerned about memory also. We want good speed, but we want minimal memory also. So essentially indexing with key is impractical. We understand that it is impractical. So what do we do? So we can definitely index with hash output of the key, and the hash function is going to return a small integer which can be used as an index into an array. That is the simple idea which is behind order 1, and thereby you achieve order 1. So what is your procedure? What do you do? The procedure is simple, that if you have to insert an element, you generate the hash function and you store. Let us say you store the element here. And when it comes to searching of the element, then you again generate the hash function you go to this slot here and you find it here where you had stored it. So the idea is very simple. While inserting, you generate the hash function and store it. While finding, you generate the hash function and find it. It's very, very simple. So that's what this slide indicates. How does insert work? You generate the hash function and you store it at that particular place. When you search it, you again generate the hash function, you know the index, and you look at that index. Is at that index we have the key which we are searching? If yes, great. If not, we return that the element is not there. It's very simple. And naturally, the same thing holds for delete. You generate the hash function, you go to that place, find the key, find the element. So that makes it too simple and too good to be true. Is a hash table so simple in reality? There are some complications. One complication is that invariably the hash function will map two keys into the same index. Invariably, you can try to avoid this situation, you can minimize the situation, but you cannot get away from it. So such condition is called a collusion. A collusion essentially means that, let us say you have this hash table, okay, you have this array of slots, and now we are saying that key 1 and key 2 both are mapping to the same place. So what do you do? There are two ways of solving it. We will see both ways, but essentially let's understand one thing, that this phenomena of two keys mapping to the same index is called a collusion. And we are now going to talk about how do we handle collusions. So as we talked, there are two ways. There is option one, which is chaining. It's like we create a chain of nodes. Chain of nodes means linked list of nodes inside a bucket. Now what is a bucket? We can understand this whole hash table, this hash table, we can understand as an array of buckets. So we can say it's a bucket 1, bucket 2, bucket 3, and so on. And we call it a bucket in the sense that a bucket can hold multiple elements. And in chaining, the bucket holds particular element, set of elements which are colliding at that particular index, in a linked list. So the idea is very simple. This hash table in effect becomes an array of head pointers, array of linked list, and in every bucket or in every slot we have a pointer to the head of the linked list. I mean, we have a head of a linked list, and the head is pointing to the first node of all the nodes which actually collided. Let us say three keys collided, K1, K2, K3, then the linked list will look like this. Maybe another two keys collided at some other index, and a small linked list would be here. So that is the first option called chaining. And now we can claim that the order efficiency is close to order 1. We can claim that the size of the hash table is large. The hash function is good, that the hash function tries to uniformly distribute the keys, and that way we expect that the linked list will not be large. Okay, so in that sense we can expect that the number of collusions would be small. So let's look at chaining in a little more detail. Essentially, it looks like this. You have a linked list inside the bucket, and all the colliding items are captured there. It's quite simple. And let's do some mathematics. Let us say you are storing 500 elements, and the size of the hash table, let us assume as, say, 1000. Okay? So expectedly, if the hash function is good, if the hash function uniformly distributes the elements between 0 to 999, then the average length of the linked list would be 0.5. That means on the average we expect every linked list to have only one node or half a node rather, which is not possible. It has to be integer 0 or 1. So essentially, in that sense, the order expected order complexity is order 1. Although we do understand the reality that if a hash table is bad and if it indexes all the elements in one linked list, then the linked list can become extraordinarily large. In the extreme case that the hash function maps everything to index 0, the order complexity would come back to the same order n, but that is not going to happen. When we create a hash function, we create a good hash function which distributes well. So that's about chaining. The other approach is open addressing, we call it open addressing. So let's recall that in chaining, in one node we used to store multiple elements. But in open addressing, we don't take that approach. In open addressing, we say that every slot can have only one element. So this slot can have one element only. This slot can have one element. This slot can have one element. So you can still call this slot a bucket, but in this case, a bucket holds only one element. So what do we do? So let us say items are colliding at this particular index. So basically, if that index is free, then naturally you store the element. If that index is not free, then the idea of open addressing is that you probe the hash table further. You look at the next index. If it is free, you store it. If it is occupied, you go ahead. Next one, occupied. Next one, free. So you find a free here, so you will store here. And while searching also the same phenomena, same method, you index, you look at that index, then the next index, then the next index, till you get a free slot. So essentially, we are building a logical list inside the table itself, and every slot is storing only one element. So that's open addressing. And let's see a little more details. In open addressing, there could be various different ways of probing. Essentially, there are different ways of probing. Probing is common. Probing, by probing, the word probing is meaning that we are probing in the hash table which slot is free. So we could do it linearly in the sense that we do at index plus 1, index plus 2, index plus 3. That would be linear probing. In case of quadratic probing, we do index plus 1 square, plus 2 square, plus 3 square, and so on. And in double hashing, we essentially use kind of two hash functions to further scatter them. We will see why and what is the motivation. We will see. Let's see one item at a time. So linear probing, the simplest one. So you look at the index. If you find the slot is empty, great, you store the element there. If not, then you look at index plus 1. Empty, store it there. If not, index plus 2, and so on, till you find a vacant slot. So this is the procedure for the insert. Similar is the procedure for searching and deleting. You start at the index generated by the hash function, and then you linearly probe the hash table. So linear probing is excellent, it's very good, and it particularly is extremely cache friendly. Cache friendly means that in general, when you are reading a RAM or hard disk, if you read a location and you read location plus 1, you are very efficient. You are cache friendly. Okay, but linear probing suffers from some problem. Some problem. There is something called clustering which can happen. Okay, clustering. We will see what this clustering is. And then this slide poses a different question. It says that Normally, if you remember that, when do we stop the procedure? We stop the procedure when we find a vacant slot. So let us say you inserted some elements. There was a hash table. You inserted an element here, you inserted an element here, you inserted an element here, and this was free. So normally things were going well. When you were searching, you searched here, then here, then here, and you stopped here. It was all well. But what happened was maybe you deleted this element, so it became free now. This slot is now free. And then let us say you are searching for this particular element. So the hash key will generate here, and then the plus one would free. So the search procedure in theory can terminate here. So it will never find this particular element. So essentially what we are saying is that we need some means of passing that element which was deleted. So there is a concept of tombstone. Tombstone is a marker indicating that the cell was at some time occupied. Hence, so essentially we are saying that you are searching through the cells and this one is occupied and this one is a tombstone and this one is occupied. So this tombstone is not occupied, it's free, but the tombstone is a marker that the search procedure has to proceed. You find here, if not find, you look here, this slot is empty, but tombstone is indicating that don't stop, don't do not stop here, keep going. Then you look here, and then you look here, and this is free, and hence you can stop. The search procedure can stop. So the tombstone is like, don't stop, keep going. You may find the element ahead. And if you are inserting an element, a tombstone is as good as an empty slot. You found a tombstone and you can store the element here and you can remove this flag called tombstone. That's the idea of a tombstone, and you need to handle this tombstone if you are doing a open addressing. Both in case of linear probing, quadratic probing, double hashing, you need to do it. Another problem is that clustering happens. Clustering. What do we mean by clustering? Let me explain. Let us say some keys were colliding here and some keys are colliding here. So you create a logical kind of list here, you create a logical list here, and these lists, this particular list is called a cluster. So it's a cluster. Cluster in the sense that you need to, when you search, you need to go through all the items. And the worst part is that adjacent clusters can merge together to form a bigger cluster. So naturally, a bigger cluster, merged, a coalesced cluster out of these two clusters means that the search procedure may be searching through this particular long area, which we don't want as such in a hash table. So this problem of clustering, making things slow, that is a little bit of a problem with a linear probing particularly. To solve that problem, people introduced quadratic probing and double hashing. Quadratic probing, the idea is that don't go linearly, spread out the cells. You saw plus 1, then you see plus 4, then you see plus 9, then you see plus 16. You spread out the cells. So when you spread out the cells, possibly clustering will not happen. Double hashing says spread out even better. So in a quadratic, the spreading is kind of is following an algorithm 1, 4, 9, 16. And you may say that if you do this on index I and then you do the similar thing on index I plus 1, this thing of 1 to 1, 4, 9, 16, you may say clustering may still happen, but in double hashing you further scatter them. You look at, there are two hash functions, hash 1 and hash 2. First, you look at hash one key. If you find empty, great. Otherwise, you create a offset. But what offset? The offset is given by another hash function. If at that offset you find empty slot, great. If not, you go at twice that offset, then thrice that offset, and so on. And the beauty of double hashing is that the offset is different for different elements. It has a element of key, I mean a incorporation of key. So naturally two different keys would be scattered using different offsets, thereby defeating and making difficult the clustering even more. Okay, so that in that sense we have these three elements, three ways: linear probing, plus 1, plus 2, plus 3, quadratic probing, plus 1, plus 4, plus 9, plus 16, double hashing, plus hash 2, plus twice hash 2, plus thrice hash 2, and where the hash 2 is a function of the key. Okay, so that's all fine. Success of hashing depends on a good choice of a hash function which tries to distribute the keys all across the array, and a reasonably large hash table size. If we are worried about memory, this hash table can be an array of pointers. Instead of becoming an array of records, array of structures, this can be an array of pointers. And that further allows us to choose a reasonably large hash table size. Typically, this hash table size, we will see that it's typically a prime number. And a little bit, almost always a large prime number. So it should be easy and fast to compute, distribute evenly, take into account all information in a key. For example, let us say you are indexing based on a student name, and the student's name is, say, Ram Kumar. Then naturally, when generating the index, you will like to consider all characters of the name and then compute the index. If you, let us say, you took into account only first character, then all the names which are starting with the same character, they will surely collide, because you looked at only the first character while generating the index. So naturally you will like to take into account all information in the key. So maybe you could do a sigma characters divided by size, which is the hash table size, a prime number typically. Now you may appreciate why it is a prime number. If it is a power of 2, then naturally in the division you will be considering only few bits. So a prime number kind of ensures that we use all the bits of this particular integer, something like that. So hash table size, it should not be a power of 2, it should not be close to power of 2. Typically a prime number serves as well. Some hash functions. One is the most simple, that you do a modulo, and modulo is the last step of any hash function. Then there are some techniques, mid square, that let's say you have a big integer. So you create a square of it, whatever that some number comes, and you take some middle element of it. Folding, let us say you have a big integer, some big integer. So you break it into different pieces and you add all of them together, or do something like that. So any such mathematical procedure, hash function is basically doing some mathematics, some small computation, some fast computation on the key. Sometimes it so happens that in spite of the best efforts, the hash table has become problematic, clustering has happened, it has become slow, and so on. So sometimes we regenerate the hash table. So when you regenerate the hash table, essentially the idea is that you create a fresh hash table. You take all the elements out and you add them afresh. For example, there were too many tombstones here. So you take the elements out and generate the fresh hash table, and then the tombstones are no more in this new hash table. And in theory, You could use a possibly a bigger hash table size when you are creating the new hash table. Maybe the first hash table was close to fill, so you dynamically expand the hash table. Even you can dynamically switch to a more suitable hashing function. It's like the program itself found that using the hash function h1 there were many collisions and this was a slow hash table. So when you create a new hash table, you chose a bigger size and a different hash function. You can do that. So that way you make it efficient. So naturally, the expected order complexity is order 1. Worst case, of course, it remains order n. But this order n will happen only if the hash table, if the hash function is extremely bad, it maps all the elements in one slot, which is not going to happen normally. In general, when we saw the chaining, nothing stops us that inside the bucket we could use a binary search tree also. Idea is to use some data structure in the bucket. And normally, more often than not, a linked list suffices. Why a linked list suffices? Because if the hash function is good, then the number of collisions is going to be small. Hence, you can use the linked list itself. Why go for a complex data structure? A complex data structure we will use when the number of elements is large. If it is small, why bother? This paragraph is saying an interesting thing. So the next slide also says it. Let us say you have a student database and you want to store efficiently based on, search efficiently based on different keys, roll number and the name and the address, say. So can you do order one search on roll number, order one search on name, order one search on address? Or let us say we are doing a order log n search on name and order one on roll number and order one on address. Can we do that? So in reality, you can always combine data structures. Let us say you store it as a binary tree based on the key called name, and hence the search using name is order log n. You wanted using roll number in order one. So what you did is you created a hash function and you set that hash function of that roll number will lead to an index, and you will find it in order 1. And you generated an independent hash table for searching with address. So you have another hash function s2 which takes the address, and when you index using that, you find the element. So essentially this hash table you index and you get address of that element. In this hash table also you index and you get address of that element. So many times you are using multiple hash tables to search by different fields. So in theory, you can always combine data structures. You can use more than one data structures to make efficient different kind of searches. So broadly, that's it for the tutorial. Thank you.